questions. Yes?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. The fourth statement reads as follows. The People's Progressive Party is disappointed with the State of the Republic address delivered by President Granger at the National Assembly on Thursday, May 12, 2016. In effect, the event was a damp squib. Heavy emphasis was placed on high-sounding and lofty ideals such as social cohesion and national unity. The speech, from all appearances, had more to do with what purports to be a Granger legacy rather than coming to grips with wrongdoings of the PNC and its reincarnation, the APNU-AFC, which has thrown Guyana into the economic and social doldrums, leaving hundreds of thousands of Guyanese wondering, and in many cases regretting, that if this is the change they voted for, then it is not welcome. To many observers, what was a striking omission in the president's address was his purposeful exclusion of the 28 years of PNC misrule under his former leader, Forbes Burnham, as well as the total deletion of any reference whatsoever to the Hoyt presidency, which he served so diligently and enthusiastically. Observers are wondering whether this is part of a carefully orchestrated narrative by Granger to distance himself from the economic and political atrocities associated with the Burnham and Hoyt presidencies, to avoid him being implicated by association and as an accessory to the crimes committed during the presidential sojourns, as in the case of the assassination of Dr. Walter Rodney. The president spoke about, quote, using this special year to usher in an era of social peace, political collaboration, and economic prosperity for generations, end of quote. It is to be recalled that past presidents of the PPPC administration spoke to these very issues when Granger was in the opposition. However, they were ignored completely, and instead, Granger pursued his party's selfish and partisan political agenda. The question being asked now is, why should the PVPC genuflect to the entreaties of the APNU-AFC in government? The president in his address pretended to be above the fray and totally oblivious to what his underlings are doing on a daily basis to create social dislocation and disintegration, as well as economic deprivation. The following examples would suffice. The dismissal of hundreds of young Amerindians from government jobs, the arbitrary dismissal and witch hunting of scores of public servants and members of state boards, the uncouth and unprofessional behavior of the APNU-AFC councillors at Region 5, RDC, the targeting of black members of the People's Progressive Party, the unsubstantiated and groundless allegations of corruption against former presidents and ministers of the PPPC government, riding roughshod in the National Assembly in treating with bills and motions brought by the PVPC for debate in that august body, dividing the Hindu community in respect to the observation of the Hindu festival of Diwali, and creating and even funding parallel organizations and NGOs to compete with long-established and well-respected bodies in order to exercise political control in certain communities. Mr. Granger and his colleagues must explain to the nation and the world how will the bridges he spoke about be built and trust restored in this hostile, anti-democratic, and anti-people environment characterized by fear and intimidation engineered by his own administration, which he spoke so glowingly and glibly about. The claim that the, quote, absence of national unity has led to political and economic fatigue, end of quote, is not only disingenuous, it is a reflection of the yawning gap between political rhetoric and the socioeconomic realities obtaining in Guyana today. And the reference to ethnic arithmetic of the past made absolutely no sense, since the APNU AFC, PNC reincarnate, cannot deny that they themselves are prisoners in the trap of racial politics from which it cannot extricate itself. The president claimed that Guyana was, quote unquote, born a broken nation. But the question many are asking, who were the midwives that delivered the broken nation? In the July 1994 edition of the History Gazette, a well-known Guyanese historian wrote, and I quote, despite Forbes Burnham's charisma, his party, the People's National Congress, appeared merely to have been used as an instrument to buttress the more powerful business interests and rightist forces which aimed at controlling political power by whatever means possible or necessary, end of quote. The distinguished Guyanese historian went on, quote, thus, the ethnic peace which the PNC party had boasted about since assuming office in 1964 is probably a coerced or contrived peace resulting from fear rather than the creative fostering of harmonious relationships among the various racial and political elements in the society as a whole, end of quote. In essence, the president's speech was best suited for a PNC Congress or a gathering of APNU AFC political operatives and activists, but not for parliament. It was basically a cover-up of horrendous magnitude and a disaster of national proportions. The National Assembly could have spent its time and money more productively debating on the motions tabled by PPPC members of parliament. The next statement reads as follows. The People's Progressive Party has taken note of the APNU AFC's advertisement entitled Guyana Unleashed in the daily newspapers to mark 1 year in government. The PPP is amused and tickled at the shameless attempt by the APNU AFC to throw dust in the eyes of the Guyanese people. Of the 50 unleashments listed in the advertisement, approximately 40 are downright lies and half-truths. A few illustrations would suffice. Number one, increased salaries for public servants. If this was the case, why did the TUC and FITO at their May Day rally demand government to delink the completion of the Commission of Inquiry into the public service from the long overdue salary increase for public servants, and which was supported in the APNU-AFC elections manifesto promise. Two, press freedom restored. If this is the case, the government needs to explain why the US State Department's 2015 report hammered the APNU-AFC government on the lack of press freedom in Guyana. Number three, local government elections held after 22 years. A blatant distortion. The facts are that the PNC utilized every effort to prevent the holding of local government elections following successive general and regional elections since 2006. They frustrated the work of the task force set up to review the laws, and as a consequence, had no alternative but to support motion after motion laid in the National Assembly calling for the postponement of local government elections. Number four, political victimization abolished, a blatant lie. Thousands were arbitrarily dismissed from their jobs on the ground of racial and political discrimination and victimization. A massive ongoing witch hunt is currently underway to purge the public service and state boards of persons suspected of being supporters of the PVPC. Five, three new townships. This is a PVP program under the Government of Guyana, CDB's Secondary Infrastructure Program. The PVP administration initiated several rounds of consultations with residents in the relevant communities. The APNU-AFC, on assumption to office, terminated the consultations and went ahead denying residents any further meaningful consultations. Declaring townships is no big deal when there are no plans for the provision of key and critical services to residents in those communities. Moreover, the naming of townships has no connection whatsoever with local government elections, especially since the elections are incomplete. Six, restored billions from phantom accounts to the Treasury, a total lie. Questions have been asked in the National Assembly about how much money had been transferred to the Consolidated Fund since the APNU-AFC assumed office. Questions have been asked time and again of the Granger administration to name the phantom accounts and how much money were in these so-called phantom accounts. While in opposition, the APNU-AFC had demanded that monies in these phantom accounts be transferred to the Consolidated Fund. To date, the APNU-AFC has failed to do so. Seven, over $40 billion for public security, lower crime rates, aggressive crime solving, fishermen protected against piracy. The security experts ensconced at the Ministry of the Presidency have all failed. They are tripping over each other, trying to prove who knows best. There is no anti-crime plan. Operation Dragnet is a colossal failure. Citizens do not feel safe on the streets, nor at work or in their own homes. Public safety and security has turned out to be a total disaster. The list can go on and on, but more will be revealed from time to time in keeping with the party's commitment to expose the lies and half-truths manufactured by sections of the media and swallowed hook, line, and sinker by the APNU-AFC while in opposition, thus making them their own worst enemy. The PPP calls on Guyanese not to be fooled nor misled by the propaganda shenanigans of the APNU AFC administration. Thank you.
There you had there two statements. Now we take questions. Who will be the first? Yes.
Mr. Ricard, I'm in the source. And your first statement, would it be correct to say that the PPP is rejecting the plans for national unity and social cohesion?
No, it wouldn't be correct to say that at all, because the PPP is on record from since time immemorial calling for national working class and racial unity. The type of national unity that Granger is calling for and the terms and conditions that he's setting for his variation of national unity is not acceptable to us, especially in the present conditions in which we are living, having regard to what they are doing in relation to the witch hunting, racial and political discrimination, victimization. The man has totally ignored all of that and has leapfrogged into a very futuristic, you know, talk about national unity and social cohesion. It can't happen under these conditions. And Mr. Granger apparently is totally oblivious to that.
The president has been talking about political inclusion since they came to office as well.
Into what?
Political inclusion since they came to office last year.
Uh-huh.
Could you give us an update on exactly what's happening in terms of talks between the PPP, the government, any invitations, anything at all? What's happening?
Insofar as talks between the PPP and the APNU AFC as political entities, no such talks are taking place. So I need to make that distinction. In terms of talk between the two political parties, namely the PPPC and the APNU AFC, there are no such or no engagements taking place. We're talking to each other through the media. Now, insofar as the leader of the opposition and the parliamentary opposition and the government benches and the president is concerned, there have been from time to time some engagements. The last one being, I think, to do with the appointment of the Chief Justice. In the parliament, if you want to call them talks, they are the subcommittees in the National Assembly and the other committees in the National Assembly where opposition and government MPs meet to discuss issues that are of relevance to the parliament. But yes, insofar as political discussions are concerned, I'm not aware of anything like that.
Do you think that's enough to achieve the type of national unity and political inclusion?
Well, first of all, we have to get rid of what is happening right now. The APN, the ball is in the government's court. They have to put an end to the witch hunting, the allegations and accusations of corruption on the part of former presidents and former ministers of government. They have to stop all of that because it is going nowhere. And we have seen, even with the publication on the Ministry of Finance's website of the results of the audits that were forensic audits that were carried out, there's absolutely nothing there. All it's hearing about is irregularities by the auditors. This should have been done, that should have been done. This should not have been done. That is the normal work of auditors. But to point to say clear examples of corruption, clear examples of abuse of authority, there's nothing of this sort there. So I'm saying that all of this must come to an end. They started out, first of all, in the wrong track. Because as I said in my statement, they believed and accepted hook, line, and sinker what the Kaicho News, and to some extent, the Starbuck News was feeding to them. They accepted that. And they went into government believing that these things were true. Now the Kaicho News itself is being called upon to retract certain statements that were made against Mr. Harmon and to pay a certain amount of money, lest legal action be taken within a certain time frame. Now, I don't know if it is true, but I've seen Mr. Adam Harris say that they're going to retract the statements You got to pull all those things down from the website, going back to the time when these allegations were made against Harmon. And then, you know, it's interesting to see how the powerful Kaichou News has now stumbled and now has to, you know, express regrets. You know, at one time the Kaichou News was thought to be invincible. You couldn't beat them. Well, now we're seeing the chickens are coming home to roost, and they're being roasted barbecue style in Lombard Street.
Yes. Next.
If I could get one follow-up, sort of like on the...
On the Kaichou News one?
No, on your first statement. Could you say why yourself and the other leader of the People's Progressive Party attended the diet school?
Why what?
Why yourself or no other leader of the PPP attended the diet school, your official capacity?
Well, I guess, you know, when you're in the opposition, you got to work hard to get back in the government. So people were all over the country. They're busy doing all kind of work, you know, and political work, political commitments. And I would want to hazard, not necessarily a guess, but what I know is that these members are all over the country. We got to work hard from now to get back in the government. No time to lose. Who was the man that sang that song? Pardon?
Was there an invitation to the party to
meet? Yes, as I said, invitations were issued to all members of parliament to attend this event. First of all, I think it was opening on Thursday, right? Thursday, there was a parliament going on. After parliament, there were other activities that members were committed to. And weekends, we use our weekends politically to go all over the country to talk to our supporters, to try to win back people who are still, you know, kind of wavering and so forth. We don't intend to wait until we have thank you meetings going on as well in respect to the local government elections. And so, you know, we're busy people. We're in the opposition now. We have to work hard.
Quick follow-up question before them, Marwee. Sir, do you think that the guide school would be a good grounds to meet constituents and that over the weekend?
Well, of course it would be, but, you know, people have their own priorities. You know, people would have their own priorities to where they should go and what way they should spend their time doing political work. So you're sure that nobody from the opposition benches went? No, well, as I said at last press conference, at the last press conference, we made it optional for MPs to attend these functions. You know, we don't corral anyone to say, you know, who should go from who shouldn't go. We leave it to the members. But the members also know they have political commitments in the countryside, in the interior, and so on to do.
Any other? Yes.
Mr. Roy, as you see it, what exactly are the conditions in Sylvanus and Granger for that community?
As what?
As you see it, what exactly are the conditions of the president for that community?
What are the conditions?
Yes. As you see it.
Well, I don't think it's how I see it. It's based on what he said. I don't think it matters so much about how I see it. It's based on what Granger himself said. You know, so what he said, I don't think is resonating quite well. And what he said is nothing new. You know, this is just a lot of empty rhetoric, platitudes, high-sounding phrases, spoke about national cohesion as the key to national unity, etc., etc. So, you know, and he's saying that we must work closer in parliament, we must forget the past, and so forth. I don't know if anyone in this hall would forget the birthday or the wedding anniversary.
Huh?
Well, unless there's anyone.
Yes.
Any Kaichou News matter? Okay.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And now it's kind of when you said there's no Steve Surjwani's been
The GCOM what?
Was always ready to look at all these elections.
GCOM could not always be ready when the laws were not in place. The task force had not completed its work. The government at the time in the cabinet was still cogitating and perusing the draft bills that were coming to the cabinet and moving through the AG's chamber. People were not in the right constituency. There was on all kind of things were happening. So, I mean, theoretically, you can say you're ready. But realistically, for a number of things to be done, you can't be ready until those things are completed. Right now, they could say they're ready for 2020 election. They could say that now, that they're ready for 2020 election. But I think most Guyanese who are, you know, sensibly thinking would recognize that in light of the past experience in the 2015 election, unless they correct those deficiencies, unless they fulfill many of the decisions and recommendations that were made at the retreat held at Carrer Lodge, you know, unless the petition in court is finally settled and heard and rulings given about whether any remedies ought to be done before the next election, you can say you're ready, yes, but there are a number of issues that are yet to be resolved.
Yes.
Off
statement? No, any statement regarding any statement? Any other question on the statement? Well, let's get the off statement question.
Mr. Rowe, there was a development story that there might have been an underhand in the camp shooter, the Hindi Han Pursuit. To what extent do you believe this was possible as former?
Where is that coming from?
A developing story, sir.
A developing story? Yes. What's the source?
To what extent do you believe it might have been possible?
What's the source?
A hidden hand in the operation.
What's the source of that?
Sorry?
What's the source of that developing story?
Demarwe is source.
You, Demarwe has carried out an investigation at the...
I'm asking, sir, to what extent do you believe it was possible?
Well, you know, I would not want to enter into the realm of speculation. That would be a highly speculative story. If I were to comment on something like that, there was a hidden hand. A hidden hand from where? By whom? To what end? So I don't want to enter into speculations about, you know, on an issue like that. You know, Mr. Ramkaran writes a regular weekly conversation tree story, I would call it. You know, he sits in the comfort of his, wherever he may be, and generates these highly speculative stories. I don't know what is the source of his information, but I wouldn't want to, you know, to comment too much on what Mr. Ramkaran says. He's entitled to his views, but we are also entitled to, you know, the truth, which is based on decisions of the Central Committee and the Executive Committee, which we would reflect from time to time at our press conferences.
No,
I think he had a follow-up.
You got a follow-up?
Yes. Okay. So can we expect the Congress this year?
Well, as I said last week, I think it was, this is a matter that has to go through a process. The executive committee considers the matter, but the final decision and members at the executive committee level are all free to ventilate their views. We have a lot of passionate discussions and views to the extent that some people misinterpret those passionate discussions and frank discussions outside of the PVP. the belief that the PPP is cracking up. We were cracking up since we were created in 1950, according to some people. And after every election, we were supposed to be cracking up too. So I don't think we get very far with that. But what I'm saying is the frank and open discussions take place on this and other matters at the executive committee. It goes to the central committee where there are more than 15 people, 38 people sit around this table and discuss this matter very openly and frankly. And they make the determination. Right now, I wouldn't want to prejudge what the central committee, because the constitution of the party says that only the central committee could postpone a Congress. It doesn't have to give any specific reasons why it's postponing the Congress. The members themselves would discuss among themselves and determine whether we should hold it this year or postpone it for another year. But I would like to say this, that postponing of a party Congress has nothing to do whether you win or you lose the election. We've held Congresses all the time throughout the years. And for someone to say that it is unprecedented to postpone a Congress, well, that's the nature of politics. Not everything in politics is predictable. So, you know, the final decision rests with the members of the Central Committee who come from all over the country. You know, and they express their views openly, and they're the ones that make the final determination, nothing to do with Rohi or Jagdeo. We are part of that body, and we will also express our views. But then there are other views which, you know, have to be contended with. Well, we have a view on this which was expressed by the former chairman of the NIS board, Dr. Luncheon, which is that he nor any of his members of the board were consulted in respect of the audit or why the audit was going on, nor were they provided with a copy of the draft report before it was finally published and sent to the Ministry of Finance and finally published. And we think that that is inherently wrong. You know, if you want a credible document, then obviously, I think the logical thing would be, with all the audits, not only the NIS and this our position, all the forensic audit reports that have been published on the Ministry of Finance's website ought to have been sent to the boards of those bodies to comment and to give their views on the audit, and then those views should have been published together with the report that finally came out. That has not happened, and we believe that is wrong. Yeah.
Many of these reports, mm-hmm.
But there's a big difference between management and the board, you know. Management answers to the board. The board is the body that takes policy decisions and gives instructions to management. So let's make that distinction between management of a corporation or the senior management of an entity as distinct from the board. Like the management of Gaisuku versus the board of Gaisuku. They're two separate entities with different mandates.
Any other questions? Yes.
Mr. Rohi, if you can agree with him on the involvement of Mr. Ramatar in the PPP, don't see him around, don't see him so much.
Who?
Mr. Ramatar.
Who don't see him around?
I don't see much.
Well, you don't work here, how you would know?
Is he still centrally involved?
That's what we asked for an update.
No, he's saying that he don't see him around.
I'm asking now, he's essentially involved.
So if you don't see him around, you see him a square? The man is here almost every day. The comrade is here almost every day. He has an office downstairs that was previously occupied by Mrs. Janet Jagan. That is the office that he now occupies. And he's here almost on a daily basis. He comes to every executive committee on Fridays. And he's here at other events to meet people and so forth. So he's here on a daily basis.
Yes.
What is the party's response to President Ukraine's pronouncements that an inquest will be set up into
the what?
That an inquest will be set up into the death of former agriculture minister Sandy Yosan?
Oh, we welcome that. They may come with the thing saying that, well, we didn't do it. Well, we didn't do a lot of things. You name one government that does everything that is committed to do in a manifesto. Take, for example, the APNU-AFC. How much have they not done? Or how much have they done, really? So I don't think we could go back to that. Well, we didn't do it, and now they're doing it. So what I'm saying in addition is that we welcome that. They're the government now. They're free to have or to open any investigation or to set up any board of inquiry or to set up any commission of inquiry, to investigate any matter that was of concern to them when they were in the opposition. So let them carry on with their investigation. They have the authority to do so now, and let the chips fall wherever they would.
Any other question? If not, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all very much.
And by the way, I wasn't angry at last press conference, as I saw was reported by one of the reporters.
Agenda.